Today's talk focuses on DaimlerBenz and their production schedule of 500 vehicles in 2 years versus Tesla's schedule, which is 10,000 vehicles in 2 years. This is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Today's talk primarily focuses on an initial discussion of DaimlerBenz and the fact that they have a plan where they've been working for years, basically 10 years, to produce electric vehicles at scale, and there are some delays in it. Just as a reminder, if this is your first time on our channel, please take time to like and subscribe. If you're a repeat visitor, welcome back. I decided to cover kind of a couple of topics today, the first one being focused on what's going on with Daimler and kind of its relationship with Tesla, as well as what's going on with the Tesla Semi and its arrival in terms of scale and batteries and price, et cetera, et cetera. So the first part of our discussion is sort of generated off of the quote that I put on the front of our video. As you know, we've sort of changed gears and started, you know, trying to do more graphics, etc. So today's talk sort of focuses on the fact that, you know, as we know, DaimlerBenz has said that Tesla really can't compete because they don't have scale around the world in terms of an efficient way to service trucking clients. Based on the number of stated customers, you know, large users have no problem with working with Tesla. And so I sort of wanted to concentrate on what's really going on at DaimlerBenz. And I say this because basically they started working on their electric trucks in 2009. It's now 2017, and they're saying over the next 2 years, they'll produce 500 vehicles. And then they'll produce 10,000 of them following that over a certain period of time, which is unknown. Now, if you read this quote, it looks really strange because it kind of looks more like what a small company would do, is they're going to produce 500 vehicles and then they're hoping to have changes that might occur that facilitate their ability to produce those 10,000 units of vehicles. The answer argument that you could off the bat make is that they're simply waiting to sort of build battery factories so they can have scale batteries to install and therefore deliver to customers. I want to present another sort of argument to this whole thing. And my argument is that what's going on right now is that Daimler knows how important the truck space is and they need to have a presence there, especially in light of the number of competitors, including Tesla, that want to be there, and that's an important component of the business of DaimlerBenz. The problem they've run into is what is the break-even point? So with the current batteries, the 18650s that they're using, they've been able to create a supercharger or ability to supercharge with those batteries, not unlike what Tesla's doing. But the problem they're having right now is that there's an issue between what they can charge after they put two or three battery packs into a truck and what customers are willing to deal with. So as we've discussed previously, Daimler has 150 units globally that are working as electric trucks that are superchargeable. Those vehicles are servicing a broad range of clients, mostly grocery clients from what I can tell, but in different industries around the world. And the goal was really to sort of get product out there, get it tested properly, and then let the falling prices of batteries allow them to produce. So the stupid question and answer of the day is, how come a company the size of Daimler can only produce 500 trucks in 2 years? And I believe that if you look at what they're doing with ICE engines or diesel engines and trucks in the United States, it wouldn't be out of line given that Daimler, you know, in the U.S., I believe we sell about 200,000 trucks a year. Daimler has 40% market share. So it wouldn't be out of line to consider that Daimler is producing between 1,000 and 2,000 trucks a month in their U.S. plants at Freightliner and Detroit Diesel to service U.S. clients, and probably similar numbers in other parts of the globe, perhaps under different brands. And so the issue was, can Daimler produce more than 500 vehicles over a two-year period? Heck yeah. They probably produce that by double on a daily basis, but not electric vehicles. And so the question is, why are they choosing to slow down the process in this manner? And it's my belief that the problem they're having is there's a break-even problem given the current cost of battery packs. So the solution to this that they've arrived at is to get a product out there, take a loss on it, but now you've seeded the market and have had everything fully tested so that once battery prices fall in line with them being able to break even, it can work out. Now, one of the questions that sort of jumps off of this is, if customers like the vehicles, why don't you go ahead and just produce them and hit them with the price that it currently costs rather than taking a loss? I think that I'll put a photo up of the truck that was developed by Walmart with, I guess, 20 partners around the world. This truck is called the Wave. I'll put a link in to the story we did on this. But basically, Walmart looked at their 66,500 trucks and said, hey, this is a cost center for us that we want to bring down. And if we can't get someone to build this truck, we'll just build it ourselves and then get those suppliers as a group to start providing us these trucks. Once Daimler, or in this case, they finished the product on behalf of Walmart, it was concluded that the price point on the truck was $385,000. So even though there were a lot of cool efficiencies that were done driving a 13-mile-per-gallon circumstance, even Walmart wasn't using the truck they were describing, because the problem you have is when an ICE vehicle costs $125,000 for a long-haul truck, having a $385,000 vehicle causes the number to be so high that it's not economically viable. So it's my belief that the problem Daimler is having and the reason they're slowing delivery of products in this regard is just that they simply can't afford to take huge losses related to the current cost of batteries. Hence, they'll delay the vehicle and get test quantities out there where they take losses. But now they're ready to rumble once they are able to get battery prices down and performance into the realm that they'd like to have it. Now, I guess found this really interesting because, you know, Daimler has talked about Tesla's inability to compete. But frankly, on the flip side of this, I don't know if you guys have noticed it, but Tesla has been able to deliver a truck in about 2 or 2.5 years. And the truck that they're delivering is able to haul 50% more freight than the Daimler products. And they're also able to get her done at a better price point. And so I just find it interesting that it's really Daimler that seems to be under competitive pressure once they have to deal head up with Tesla, both in cars and in this case in semi-trucks that we're choosing to cover. This kind of brings up my next topic, which is there's an interesting phenomenon happening, which is that the Model 3, because of how Tesla is choosing to produce their trucks, seeing Model 3s and how they're rolling out and how they're doing is a huge deal, because once they're able to get at scale, and I think scale is between 5 and 10,000 units a month, they'll reach break even and then be rolling into profit on the battery packs that are coming out. And so it's my belief, therefore, that Tesla is in a great position because you basically have a battery pack that's about $10,000. $8,500 is the estimate at scale of what the battery pack costs for the Model 3. But basically, when you load three of them on top of each other, you have the smaller semi at 150K. And if you load four of them, you're getting the longer range semi capable of 500 miles. That the Founders Edition is $200,000, but they're charging $180,000 for this. Now, I'm fascinated because one of the things that's going on here that's really interesting is that the CTO of Tesla informed us that they're not really a car company, a truck company per se. They're really a storage business, and they're backing their way in storage, the storage business, from storage into vehicles. And I think this is a really interesting sort of thought process, because one of the big sort of question marks that lurks is that the distance between Tesla and competing firms becomes a fairly large gap, because as everyone has deduced, the price that Tesla is selling trucks at is the break-even, or is the cost of batteries alone, not even the break-even point for comparable semi-trucks. The only trucks that you could theoretically look at is that BYD is doing a $300,000 truck that goes 100 miles, and it has very limited usage based on the price, but it is being used by folks right now. And so one of the things that pops up is that, yeah, I believe Tesla's making a 50% margin on a truck. I also believe, based on where competitors are at, like BYD, there's room for Tesla to charge as much as $250,000 for the truck with no problem. And part of the question is, like, why are you guys doing this? Because you could charge more realistically, because the value proposition offering to customers is so good. And the answer is that if Tesla is able to bring customers in on both this energy storage side as well as the truck side, you now have customers that you're making a profit on in two different arenas. And so I think this really makes the challenge even more difficult for competitors, because now you have to face a company that has an aggressive price on their product. And if you don't have storage capabilities to compete with Tesla, you have them making money in another quadrant that helps fuel the lower prices on trucks without any issues. So I just think that it's a daunting task for most firms to deal with what Tesla is bringing, the 1-2 punch of both offering electricity to customers and offering a low-priced truck that already is disruptive, because they're the only ones that can do it. And so we're kind of having that out there. Now, so this is a point where we kind of run into some difficulty usually. I've noticed that you guys typically stick around for 8 to 10 minutes. And, you know, there are other issues that I like to cover, but I guess I'll just set up some of the other things that we're going to be looking at. One of the biggest sort of problems that's going on with Tesla right now, both as an investor and, you know, as a casual viewer, is how transparent are they and what's going on. So most of the negative news on Tesla is very common, broad-based, and sort of well-funded. But Tesla doesn't seem to be responding aggressively to any of that. And I wanted to suggest that our next talk is going to be about something that I call need-to-know journalism. So what you'll notice is that one of the data points, there have been a bunch of data points behind the scenes on the semi that have come out. One of them is that Tesla started having potential customers drive the truck for over a year. And so not only did they see it when it was in a mule form, when it was built into a pre-existing Freightliner truck, but the customers have had multiple opportunities to drive the vehicle as its finished form that you saw at the introduction. So I thought it was fascinating to watch how there were all these people that were making comments about the fact that there are other firms like Daimler or Cummins that had beat Tesla to the punch of a delivery of a new product. But basically what Tesla has been doing is that if you're not buying our products, we'll give you a little bit of information, but in general, you don't get any information at all. And for those potential customers who actually blab about what's going on during those trials, some of them have been actually cut out of the order process or pushed to the back of the line based on spilling the beans. I think this is a smart move on Tesla's part to restrict information flow, because I think that the company is still vulnerable to little issues like, for example, for competitors noting components that they really need or parts that they need. They could theoretically facilitate shortages that might hamper Tesla's forward progress. So there's a great deal of silence you'll notice around Tesla. It's implied that they just don't know what they're doing or can't do what they're talking about. But the reality is that I think they do know what they're doing. But the problem is that silence is kind of golden until you've built out and successfully started running everything, so that competitors can't sort of climb into their supply chain and become a problem in some way. And by the way, I'll remind you that one of the problems Tesla ran into was that in the early days, they had one of the ways that large competitors were dealing with them was to go to suppliers and say, Tesla will never sell more than 2,000 or 3,000 vehicles. So you guys shouldn't tool or prepare for them to do any more than that. And this resulted in sort of monkey wrenches in supplies of the Model S and other vehicles over time for Tesla. So hence the secrecy plan has really sort of come to bear. And we're going to dive into this a little bit in terms of how Tesla deals with the Wall Street Journal and some other entities in our next video. So in the case of this, I just wanted to look at the fact that Daimler's in a tight space right now. There's a limited top end of what they can charge and still have customers interested in buying or able to buy for CapEx their trucks. They definitely have model or class 7 trucks on the road right now. Those trucks are being leased out in the $1,000 a month range as kind of loss leaders to sort of test the market and make sure customers are happy. But they're really waiting to try to get battery prices down so that they can maintain what the price is, get to scale on production, and still be able to make a profit, which they really can't do in the current numbers. In fact, 500 trucks over 2 years, I don't think they break even on the production lines. But again, it's a worthwhile loss given that you're kind of seeding the future. I'm looking forward to what you guys have to say about this. I think it's fascinating to watch a company the size of Daimler struggle against Tesla. It's a interesting process to watch how we get to the future with a smaller company sort of leading the bigger company around by the nose. Again, look forward to any and all comments you might have. This is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Tschüss, mach's gut, auf Wiedersehen, rohot, walk good, enough respect, and have a great day.